Team tonight.
Hey, Walt, tell me when you're ready. Okay, everyone. If I could call the special meeting to order. Welcome to the joint meeting of the Enfield Town Council and the Enfield Board of Education. It is Thursday, February 2nd, 2012. And may we start with a roll call of the council first, followed by the board.
Councilman Arnone?
Here.
Councilman Bosco? Councilman Crowley?
Here.
Councilman Ector?
Right,
Hall.
Here.
Okay, well, good evening, everyone. And this meeting's been called to give both the Town Council and the Board of Education an update on, as you can see from the agenda, on the high school consolidation process. And it's going to be a bit interactive, and because it's a joint meeting, we encourage dialogue and discussion. We'll have, I think, either a handout or a presentation by Matt. But also I know that there's specific points that Tim wants to address. And again, anyone's free to ask a question, chime in with a comment. And between the two of us, we'll just do our best to make sure that we recognize you and call on you. So the first item, item number two, is an update on the high school consolidation process. And Tim, do you want to start off any conversation?
I'll be happy to. What we want to do is kind of give folks a timeline of, you know, when this started, why we're doing it, and so on. And we're doing it mainly because there are changes from the State Department of Education that's going to require us to do some updates to the schools, and that necessitates some thinking about what was the best way to do that. They all involve some significant changes in terms of labs and technology and so on, and if we were looking at doing it to both schools, and as part of the reorganization process, you decided to take this up, to postpone it initially, and deal mostly with the pre-K to 8 consolidation first, and then move on with the high school. But the reasons for getting involved with this had to do with changes that were being given to us by the State Department of Education, and also our declining enrollment and our need to look at things in a more efficient and way, and to correct some of the issues that we've had with some of the buildings. I think there's also an issue of we're being cited, and I can't think of the right agency, John.
It's Title IX handicap accessibility.
Handicap accessibility at Birmingham, and we've had that on the table for a year or two, and we have to address it. And I believe it's been close to or in excess of $1 million to do some of those upgrades that were there. In fairness, if they had come into Enfield High School, we'd probably got to do some similar ones there because they were the same types of reasons that they gave us for firming. So we were trying to address that and address the declining enrollment, and I think we considered actually 3 plans. One, keeping Fermi open. 2, keeping Enfield High open, but also doing nothing. And I bring up doing nothing because it's not free. Because of the demands of the state, we would have to do the changes even if we decided not to consolidate in one school or the other. And I think that's what brought us up to this point. you folks, you may be able to give a better description of the work that went on with, is it Four Square or?
GM Square.
GM Square. I always get that wrong. I don't know why. And the work that's been going on with the committee for the last year and a half, I think,
sure.
at least. So maybe I'll turn it over to you
okay.
for that piece.
And what Tim's referring to is, as everyone knows, we have the Strategic Planning Committee. The current committee, and it's equal representation from the council, equal representation from the board, equal representation of political parties. So Pat Crowley and Cindy Mangini from council Democratic side, Bill Lee and myself from council Republican side. And on the Board of Education side, now we've got Tina and Tim. Previous board, Judy Aparisi-DeRoche and Joyce Hall. But Joyce, Tina
Actually,
and Joyce are back and forth,
Joyce,
right?
Yeah, I
Tina was
Joyce.
Filling in for
okay.
Joyce. Joyce is the
That's right.
the member.
And Joyce is at the end. Sorry, Joyce.
I'm here.
And Chuck Johnson and Greg Stokes when Greg was on the board, and Greg has been replaced by Donna Suzak. So, and we've been staffed with Dr. Gallagher, Matt Koppler, and anyone that we needed to call on. And really, as Tim had mentioned, the first process was the elementary and middle school reorganization. Although we are having conversations regarding the high school consolidation for well over a year, and really picked up that ball back in the summertime, and came to this point where at early in the process, Tim had mentioned GM Squared. GM Squared was a consultant that was brought in to look at renovation expansion of both high schools. But one of the components that they were looking at was a ninth grade academy. And a lot of the numbers that were driven by the GM Squared report was in fact the ninth grade academy. And it's my understanding that the board early in the process dropped the idea of a ninth grade academy. So that really the numbers that GM Squared put out there, there's components of it that are applicable, but a big chunk of the GM Squared report, because of the not the willingness to go forward with a separate ninth grade academy at either campus or both campuses, brings us to this point where the board has made the decision, and it's solely in the board's realm and of responsibility to select the high school. And now the Strategic Planning Committee and the town begins the process to bring this through to referendum. So what I'm going to do is I would like Matt and John, before we move to number three, is there any questions on this this short historical update of Strategic Planning Committee, board decision of Enfield High, and the consolidation process before we move into the timeline of referendum?
I could just throw some more comments out there in terms of the selection process.
Okay.
Certainly there's been lots of comments about it. I think people are very concerned, and as I've mentioned several times at these meetings, it's a very emotional topic. Okay, all of my kids went to Fermi. I think you went to,
I went to Fermi.
Okay,
yeah.
And so we were trying to separate the emotions and our feelings about that. They all got a good education there, and I have no issues with that at all. But I think as a board, and in fact, we were, the first decision was made by the previous board in terms of that they were leaning that way. I think it came to us as a final decision to meet this timeline is to choose between the two based on the data that we had at that point. And we had discussed it a considerable amount of time. A number of the members had gone to the meetings. Everybody had read all the reports that had come out on that. And I think it came down to what was the best choice for the community based on, a large part had to be based on finances. And I think if you looked at the schools, Fermi has nothing due on that at this point in time, but the payback on Enfield High School is 2.6, I believe. I'm pretty close to $2.6 or $2.7 million. So that was one feature. We looked at the issue of the changes that would have to happen because of the siting that we had, but we dismissed that because that would be in both schools. You know, that was our assumption. I think we also looked at the soil issue and the cost of that. And I have to say, it's not an exact cost because we couldn't get a definite answer from anybody that would tell us exactly what those issues were, except that it would be expensive. And I think we had already, the town had already dealt with that earlier on when they did the fields, and our understanding is some things have changed since then, become more restrictive. And I think it became a liability in the discussion. But I think it essentially, and it was, we had eight members there and we had an 8-0 vote on that. I think people felt comfortable that at this time, with the knowledge that we had at this time, with the financial impacts on the town, with the discussion of the facilities and the needs and so on, that this was the right decision to go. And we tried to keep emotions out of it, we tried to keep our loyalties out of it and so on, but make a decision. And that's how we came to it.
Tim, that's approximately, as of August 28th, 2011, it was $2.9 million for Enfield High.
Thank you very much.
Okay. Pat.
Scott, I just want to, not correct, but just, I believe our conservative estimate for the renovations at Fermi for the CHRO claims was closer to $2 to $3 million, not $1 million. I believe there was a bigger number there.
I'd have to defer to
if I can.
Yeah, just in estimates, we're looking in that neighborhood. I mean, we felt that it was going to be a lot fairly substantial.
So, Matt, you're saying that the number for the handicap accessible ADA requirements is in that $2 to $3 million range?
Yeah, that's what we've estimated. Yeah.
Okay.
For school?
No, that's just to correct Fermi.
So probably.
And the issue with Fermi is that Fermi's been cited by the state, and we've been working with the state. We have to come up with a plan, but they're giving us some latitude as we work through the reorganization of the system.
Yeah. Yeah. Dr. Gallagher has been in contact with them, keeping them informed of where we stand in this process, and the thought is that if we are moving towards getting out of Fermi as a school, that they would not push us to try to get that renovation done. So,
okay.
Also on the GM Square, that report, the accessibility, Enfield High scored higher for two reasons. The recent renovations address accessibility in a significant portion of the building, and the non-compliant areas of the school are more readily adaptable than comparable areas at Fermi.
Thanks, Dan.
Tom.
So what was the number for Fermi? We have a firmer number for Fermi for the ADA?
No.
We have a guess?
Because we've been putting this off, we haven't utilized any architect to go in and actually do all the estimation for it. Again, the number that I'm using is based upon our discussions with GM Squared, trying to ballpark what they thought that would be. If you look into their report, they kind of get into it a little bit, and it kind of falls in that $2 or $3 million range.
That's safe to say, right around the same.
Yeah. Could be higher, could be a little bit lower, but until you really get somebody in there to do all the nitty-gritty work with it, you really don't know. It's all estimation.
Thank you.
Okay, does Carol?
Matt, do we have an Excel spreadsheet on, as Tim said, doing nothing isn't an option, but doing nothing, leaving both high schools as they sit, what the cost to do both high schools, what the cost is to move to Enfield High, what the cost is to move to Fermi. Do we have anything that we can look at to compare what the cost is with each of the options that was looked at?
Yeah, what was done to this point or up to that point, the work by GM Squared, they put numbers together for the renovation costs for each of the schools, but they didn't look, in terms of the total cost of doing the not doing anything versus the other two, because they were looked strictly at just what would it take to move X amount of students into a facility based upon all these different criteria that they would have to meet.
Okay, is it possible to get some sort of spreadsheets with all the scenarios so we can look at what was looked at? I mean, I haven't seen any numbers or anything. Is there anything out there?
It would have to be created.
Are I'd like to see the numbers with all the scenarios myself.
The thing to remember on that is you won't be looking at apples and oranges, because if you have the two schools, the number for GM Square, I think, was built around a building about 1,800 students, if I'm not mistaken, on that report. If you kept your two high schools separate and wanted to find out what it would cost to upgrade, you still come back to the big issue there of the declining enrollment. Your enrollment is declining. So we can crunch some guesstimates and give you some numbers, but you're also looking at the operating cost of two buildings that would have to be factored in there. In terms of double administration, double faculty positions in certain cases, double custodial services, so you need to kind of look at that when you're looking at it as well.
Right.
It just won't be a clear, hard number.
But if we're going to keep the building open anyway, on the town side, we're looking to keep that building up and running. We're not going to be closing a building, so... You know, we're going to have operating costs on that side of it. I understand the scholastic side of it. I understand that.
And just, you know, maybe to put some numbers out there, November 2010, we did a presentation on the savings or the reduction in costs by going from 2 to 1.
Mm-hmm.
And just on the school side, based upon... Again, the number of teachers they had there and administrators, so if there's been any change in those, this may not be reflective of that because we haven't updated it since then. But on the school side, in salaries and benefits, there was a savings of about $1.3 million. And then when you looked at substitutes, athletic savings, transportation savings, the total estimate at that point in time was really about almost $1.7 million. Now, we looked at then also from the town side, which would be the custodial changes and utilities. It was kind of hard to benchmark really what we thought the reduction in utilities, because we assumed that it would still be operational in some manner. But we thought that number was probably around 50,000 conservatively. Could be more, could be less, depending upon what ultimately that use would be. Custodial. The way it operates now, we assumed would not be operated the same way. We have dedicated people there during the day that we may not need all those individuals there. So, you know, that would range anywhere from no savings whatsoever up to about 187,000. So we kind of looked at, you know, at most that savings in the $200,000 to $225,000 range from the town's part of it. So, I mean, that kind of gives you an understanding of what we think the efficiencies are by going from 2 to 1, mainly on the school side.
If we could see something, Matt.
Yeah,
I mean,
yeah, what I'll do, and because I'm trying to think, is, you know, what is the best way at least to get you information. I can get out to everybody the presentation that we did, which is a PowerPoint, which has a lot of these numbers. So you can not only see what the cost changes would be, but you can also see what those GM squared cost numbers were for doing different tracks in terms of renovate as new versus just a limited renovation and expansion, and how, in fact, you know, based upon the numbers we talked about, where we could fit the cost of those expansion renovations within the savings dollars that would be generated. So we'll get that out to the council, and I think actually the board may have already received that a few weeks ago, if I'm not mistaken. So
I'm not sure I got it then, or I got it when I was at that meeting. So
thank you.
All set.
Yep.
Dr. Gallagher?
I think at the meeting you're talking about too, one of the things that came out of strategic planning, we brought it back to the board. The feeling was that it would be unfair for the taxpayers here to really investigate keeping both buildings, to actually come in and have an architect do both buildings with different proposals for both buildings and incur the cost of that. And I think the committee was in agreement, and the board agreed with their recommendation, that we needed to decide on one site. So the situation, I think, for the board was, which of the two schools were we most interested in? And obviously they've already selected Enfield High as their choice. So I think we can give you some ballpark figures, but I definitely wouldn't encourage incurring more cost to have an architect come in and round out some numbers for you, because it gets expensive.
Right. No, I understand.
I think that was actually discussed, and the additional dollars to spec this out, it was exorbitant to get that level of detail. And I think that entered into our decision too, to even ask for more information.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Tom,
a couple of the points I was going to ask about were already just hit there. The when you you take two buildings and you leave them open, there's duplicity in some of the programs, the labs, some of the things we're going to be doing that we would still have to do, those millions of dollars. And then there's also the whole payroll piece where, you know, you have to have two of this and two of that and two of this, some of which can overlap with the body of students being in one location. You'll still need a, you know, you're not going to cut it in half, but you are going to reduce it. The soil remediation thing, I would like to hear a little bit more about that, because, and I understand there's, you know, we haven't had the scientist team come in and bore holes and get the number, but the number for the public that's being thrown around there is anywhere from, I hear, $8 million to up to even $50 million with some changes in the laws, environmental laws, being stricter now, causing us to have to do more, and I hear we have to, you know, take 30 feet of soil out and deliver it to Utah, kind of a solution, and replace it as opposed to capping like we did before. So if anybody here has a little bit more on that, I think that would help.
Yeah, you know, we talked with, again, GM Squared about trying to understand, you know, what those type of costs. Again, it's going to depend upon what actually you do at that site. You know, what we've done thus far is we've capped it. And so taking that concept, you know, if we're adding more parking, that's capping. So it's not really going to be any cost to adding more parking to that. Obviously, if we're expanding the building, the footprint of the building, we're going to be digging into contaminated soil. You know, it could possibly be housed on site and capped as a feature somewhere, or it would have to be taken to a landfill, a hazardous waste landfill. You know, and again, I don't think we're talking tens of millions of dollars. We may not be talking really in the grand scheme of a renovation, millions of dollars. We just don't know. But again, the footprint that was talked about with GM Squared, I can't remember offhand what that size was. I think it was about like 28,000 square feet, maybe. You know, we're not talking about a lot of soil that has to be, you know, taken care of.
All set. Good. Pat.
Yeah, one of the other things that really came into consideration, at least for me, from the committee, was the fact that the Public Safety Academy is building a new high school also. So basically for us to have, even though it's not town run, essentially have three high schools in this town, the declining enrollment just really wasn't feasible. So I think that's another issue that was part of the thought process that we went through. So, it was thrown in there. You know, with the declining enrollment, two high schools, we had some space. You know, third high school put in there, and there's no telling what the numbers are going to be, but we'll probably lose some students to that also. So that was also, I think, the factor that we put into it. So I'm going to throw that out there.
Okay, anyone else on this topic, on the item number two, update of high school consolidation process? Be good to move to review of the consolidation time frame with important benchmarks and dates. Matt and John, you're the two that put this together, so do you want to run down the timeline and the benchmarks?
Yeah. Actually, I want to defer to Matt because he did the bulk of the work on it. I just read through it after he did it. But I do what he's done. I want to hand out something that was handed out prior, and what I have, we'll just hand it out after Matt's presentation, was a proposed timeline by our two principals on actually moving into the building. So I think this dovetails into what Matt has.
Okay.
And it will be a reminder for those of you that have seen it before.
Great. So.
Yep, and I believe everybody, as they came in, I handed out the handout that has the time frame. The first three items on this have already been undertaken. Of course, the Board of Education has selected Enfield High as the primary consideration for consolidation. Last week, we opened up the RFQs for architectural services. We received, I think, 29 firms applying for that. Another one that I didn't put on here, but I would like to point out, we also have brought on Art Pongrantz, who is in the audience. Wave your hand, Art. Right there. There he is. And hopefully everybody either remembers or knows who Art is. served many years for the Board of Education as their facility manager, has a lot of battle scars going down to the State Department of Education for projects, and we were very fortunate that we could negotiate his employment with us for this period. We had to put up a fight with grandchildren. And we won thus far, but you never know. But we brought Art on to help us through the process that we're going to have to be going through to get this to the state and ultimately to referendum. We're looking at February 20th, which would be a council meeting date, actually, where the town council will establish a pre-referendum steering committee. In fact, I've included as part of the handout, the last piece is the resolution that council will be hopefully adopting Monday night that will set the pre-referendum steering committee into motion. And you're probably aware that we are advertising right now for members to apply for that. On the 20th, our expectation is council will actually make the appointments necessary to start. And that will be the true start date, hopefully also for the architect 3 days later to begin working with them and our staff to do a lot of the work that you're going to be seeing here. February 28th, we're hoping that we'll be able to get an 8-year estimated enrollment for the facility established. We moved to April 15th, and at that point, the architect, working with the steering committee and staff, will develop a professional cost estimate for the education specifications. And then a critical path action happens April 30th, where the council will have to authorize the funding for the local share based upon those ed specifications. May 1st, the ed specifications will be completed, which then leads to May 15th, another critical path item. The Board of Education adopts the ED049, the grant application, and the educational specifications. And this is all the critical components to get everything to the State Department of Education, because one of the financial considerations is getting funding from the state of Connecticut for the renovation expansion to help reduce our overall costs at the local level. June 1st, we'll begin work with our bond council on the resolutions necessary for council to act to put this on as a referendum. June 30th is our drop-dead date to get everything into the State Department of Education so we can start seeing what that reimbursement will look like. Art has informed me that it'll be done a lot sooner than June 30th, so keep that up. July, council will be voting to schedule a public hearing on the referendum question. August 6th would be that hearing, as well as hopefully an adoption by council to put this on the ballot ultimately. September 1st is the general time frame where we need to get the question to the Secretary of State so we can have it on the ballot. And then November 6th, of course, is the vote. And the only other thing that I wanted to point out, the next page of what I handed out are, along the way, some of the formal actions that council and the Board of Education will have to take. You know, one of the things that council will be doing in the month of February, probably at the second meeting, is we have to do some appropriation for those pre-referendum activities, primarily helping pay for Art's time, as well as paying for the architect service over the period from today, or once they're selected, to the referendum. Obviously, you have to appoint a referendum high school consolidation committee that we talked about, and then some of the things that we talked about already, the authorization of the local share, the referendum hearing, as well as the referendum and the associated resolutions.
Thank you, Matt. John, you wanted to offer some thoughts from the principals?
This is a two-sided document, and some of you have seen it before. And I won't read it to you, but basically, under the timeframe that Matt's spoken about, I think the magic date is right on the very front there, the November 2012 on this document. And what it's saying is that basically that's the linchpin for the whole thing. I think from where we're sitting and where the Strategic Planning Committee was talking, the referendum is critical to this. If it doesn't pass, obviously, the following dates wouldn't happen. If it did pass on 2012, you actually be able to start work on July 1 of 2014. So as you look through this document, you'll find down in September 2014, it says, depending on building utilization, some renovations could begin. That's when the state would start reimbursing you. If you did any work prior to July 1, 2014, the state will not reimburse you. But basically, this is showing you how they're transitioning the Fermi students and the Enfield students into one student body. And you can follow it. And if this was the path that we took, by 2016, the consolidation would be complete. That's on the very back of it. As I said, I don't want to read it to you. It's self-explanatory, and I think most of you, if not all of you, have seen it before. It was just more or less a reminder. So if you have any questions on any of those years or the things that are there, Mr. Duffy is in the audience here. He worked on this with Mr. Newton, and I think between him and I, we probably can answer your question.
Okay. Thanks, John. Questions on Greg?
I just have one question or observation. In the course of this, I know we talked about it at the last Strategic Planning Committee, but can we begin to look at a two or three or whatever of community conversations so that we can include the community into this? Because you're not going to get buy-in if they're not, you know, we're just going to have a hearing down the road, and then the hearings are what they are. Just want to make sure we have those in there. So.
That was the assumption of the committee. We actually had made some proposed dates, I think, for these types of meetings and events.
I think we looked at a minimum of three once the architect has been selected and is on board and working with Art and the steering committee. Looking for one, thinking March, May, and then a final one prior to council action. So sometime in that, every 2 months, 6 weeks, or however they feel that they're moving along in the process, but early in the process, middle,
right,
and then prior to final design and final action, so that it all can be incorporated. Because as most of you should know, is a lot of what is presented and gets drawn up in plans becomes part of the record, and the expectation that is what is going to happen if the referendum is approved. So it's not just the text on the ballot and the explanatory text, it's the drawings and the designs that become part of the record and part of the expectation that people are voting on.
Just a follow-up, and I know I'm saying this probably for folks that haven't heard me say this. One thing that we found during the elementary and middle school consolidation was we started putting things on the school website, and we tell folks go to the school website, and there's an area for it. And you know, after that lesson we learned there, I kind of felt that maybe as we move on this, if we can create its own website for this, what we're doing now, call it Vision 2016 or something, that way it's just my opinion, it's a individualized autonomous website for this. So no one gets confused with what they're looking at. People know exactly where to go. You know, just like we've done recycling, we promote this website so information is clear. Because I do know, people have said referendums are hard to pass, especially in this climate, and I agree with that. But I also think that there are a lot of folks in our community, all they're asking for is clarity of information and a clear resource to get to, and forums to be able to find out what's going on. Because obviously it's their money and their decision, so just for that.
Thanks, Greg. Carol?
Two quick questions, and I don't know if Matt or Dr. Gallagher can answer. When we did the elementary school renovations and JFK originally, we did have an idea of the percentage of reimbursement from the state before we even got to the architectural drawings.
Yep.
Part of it. So the first part of my question goes to, do we have an idea of what the reimbursements may be for what the committee has proposed, if we've got a rough estimate or a guesstimate yet?
We can provide you what it would have been for this year from Mr. Mahoney's office at the school facility unit. The state hasn't set it for the following year, but it will be very close. In fact, we probably can give you is maybe 3 years' worth, and you can see. Typically, Enfield's been in the 62 to 68, 70% on the dollar reimbursement range.
Okay.
So we can get those numbers for you for the last 3 years. I just can't tell you what it would be in 2013, because it hasn't been set by the state.
All right. I think that would be helpful. And it goes to what Greg was saying before. When we did pass the last referendum for the school additions, we provided the public with as much information as we could, and the referendum passed, and granted it was better times. But I think if they have all the information in front of them, and just a point of clarification of what I was looking for, Matt, before, is, you know, showing the public that there is going to be savings to put these huge dollars on the table for the renovations, I think they have to know that the other alternatives were going to cost more, or the payback is going to be huge doing it this way. So in my opinion, to sell this, we really need to show the savings dollars, and that's what I'm looking for.
Yeah, and that I think as part of the strategic planning committee, you know, that was talked about at length, the need to do that. It's just sitting here today, a lot of this stuff, because again, we have to go and refresh all the numbers again.
Right.
It's going to take a little bit of time to do that, but yep. The intent is to have that as part of the process.
Perfect. Yeah. Thank you.
Tim?
I this has come up at our other meetings, but just for the sake of the audience here, we've talked about the just lost my train of thought here. That's really, is that a senior moment? I don't know.
No, it's a board chairman's moment. Yeah.
I had a lot of those. Don't worry about it. Don't worry about it. It's permanent, by the way.
Is it?
Are you passing?
I'll pass for now.
When it comes back. Tom?
Yeah, just quickly on the timeline. Is there an explanation of really why you chose to make this timeline? Is the 11th and 12th graders at Enfield staying there just so they can graduate out? Is that really the reason for this, as opposed to maybe putting in modular classrooms and putting them all over quicker?
I saw that both principals are in the room now, and if they could, they could come up and they could explain.
Please.
It if you wanted to take
time.
Yeah,
I think
so
the public would like to hear.
Come up. So Mr. Newton, Mr. Duffy wanted to come up and grab a couple of chairs for you. While they're coming up, I just mentioned on the information, and I know Mrs. Hall sent some materials out from CABE, I believe, but your information has to be voter neutral. You can't be promoting or against, because it involves a referendum. So hopefully, and the planning committee talked about this, hopefully there will be a political action committee formed, and that would be people that we would hope would favor the project. They have total freedom on what they want to do, as long as they're not funding it with taxpayer money or using facilities or paper from the school. That's those are no-nos. But if you have a PAC form, that I think there was a PAC, if I'm not mistaken, when they did the elementary. I'm looking back here at Sunderland, because I see you have quite a few faces from the building committee back there. I see Randy Daigle and George Rippish and Mrs. Anderson. There's a few back there, and there were PACs formed back then. So if that happens, that would be something that would give you a lot of freedom in terms of where they are. So with that said, if you guys want to give them the madness to the plan there.
I'll take that on a little bit. The first thing we got was a lot of feedback from parents early on, saying that they'd like to see it more done as a phase out or phase in kind of a situation. So that we weren't moving multiple grade levels all at one time. So that played into it to a large degree. Also, just the size of our existing facilities and trying to do it in a way that we thought we could do it utilizing all of our existing facilities and not having to rent or do anything else to in terms of incurring additional costs. So by following that timeline, we also kind of matched it up against when we figured the Public Safety Academy would be out of Stowe, so that we could send, in that third year, we could send the ninth graders out of JFK to that building, because it's ours, and not incur any additional costs, and still make it kind of fit in all the buildings that we currently have. So that played into that decision. And then the other part was, we thought that at least
that those kids that are at Enfield High would probably want to stay there, or to the longest degree possible. And also, by only having two grades in there, we figured you could manipulate where those kids are. So if you wanted to start some of the building project that's during that year, you're not building on top of spaces where there's kids in them, and we figured by only having two grades in the building, you could segregate them to wherever they need to be, and then you could do work over there, because we didn't know for sure if just 1 year was enough to do all the construction that was necessary. So this would actually give you 2 years to do the necessary construction. So it was just kind of like that compounding of all those factors interwoven together made it look like this was the smart way to go with it. Does that make sense?
Just one more thing, an important piece is the science and the technology, science labs in particular. Neither school has the ability to house what is currently the 11th, 12th grades together, just in the lab sciences, and schedule them all within a normal school day. So that was another major feature in keeping the kids before they're rebuilt. And with having the zones in Enfield High, it does the A and the D wings in particular, you can isolate them. The fire zones, alarms are separate, and entrance and exits are separate. So it really was a matter of pure logistics and practicality when it comes to scheduling the kids in classes, particularly in the labs.
Thank you.
Okay. You might just hang around because someone may have other questions.
I feel bad because Mr. Stokes doesn't have his chair.
Oh, that's all right. Tina.
Yes, I actually have a two-part question. One being, I'll follow up with Mr. Newton and Mr. Duffy. I guess when I look at the proposed timeline, the one piece that I'm concerned with is housing the ninth graders that 1 year somewhere else. And that just sticks out to me that, moving to them to perhaps Stowe, there's no guarantee that the PSA is going to even be out of Stowe at that time. And just segregating them like that for a year, that just concerns me. That's all. That's my comment. I don't know if there's a way around it.
I guess you could put a bunch of portables all around one site, but I don't know if that would, I don't know if that's a lot better. I don't know.
It was just a tentative plan. I think what we were doing was we visited, or at least I visited the academy over there at Stowe, and they brought in mobiles. They have 400 students in that building right now, and your ninth grade class is running about those kind of numbers, low eights, 400. So, or high threes, 400s. And I think what we were looking at was where would we be able to house them, and part of what it would involve would not only them being out, but correct, letting us use the mobiles or letting us lease the mobiles or whatever. So we were just looking at something saying this is a possibility, and that's why we were very careful when we put this down saying proposed. There's things in here that need to be worked out, and it was just a thought.
Because you never know if you're going to have construction issues. I was just watching the news the winter we had.
That's right, or strikes or material problems or all kinds of things going on.
Right, we need kind of an additional plan if our construction falls behind.
Yeah, I think it recognizes that we're going to move a group of students, yet keep them together. We were not consulting with an architect. There was no construction sequence that we would follow, but the concept, I think, is very solid in that. You have to be aware of it, and it will involve some transportation.
Right.
It may involve some portables, and all of those unknowns put us into the proposed. But the concept of using that as a modular, in a sense, was what we're trying to get across there.
We also would still consider them to be fully part of the regular high school program. So if there were, particular students that maybe needed, or accelerated in a course, we would just figure to provide the transportation to get them over to the other building and that kind of
right,
a thing.
Right, because they don't have science labs at the PSA right now. Do they have science labs?
I don't know, but a lot of our science and introductory physical science don't need the same kind of lab facilities that you would normally. A lot of those, that can be done in classroom and lab off carts for the ninth grade curriculum. So it's doable, but it's not optimum. And we can always make changes too.
The second part is I'm understanding the renovations that were to be done to the high school choice. They have to be like new to get a better reimbursement from the state. Am I correct in saying that?
There's different levels of reimbursement, and Art can speak to that much better than I can, but there's levels of reimbursement. My understanding is, and Art, you'd yell if I'm saying this wrong, if you renovate to new the entire building, it's a higher rate than some of the other things, because there's certain things that they'll consider just maintenance after a while. They'll just sit there and say, we're not going to do that. But if you're actually doing a total redo of the building, you probably will have a more favorable rate than if you were just selecting and just doing the science wing and then not touching the rest of it. And then let's say they came back and cited you for a compliance at that point, you would have to come up with the money on your own because they don't consider the compliance reimbursable.
Okay, thank you.
Tom, did you?
No, it got answered.
It got answered. Yeah. Tim?
She pulled my senior moment right out of the hat.
Okay.
Actually, I think that building to new is the big thing. It's like we're talking about renovating or building to new. I know that just the age of the building, that was built, what, 61 or 60 or something
61
like that?
61 for that one.
Yeah, and we're talking about the electrical issues and stuff like that. It was built for two plugs in every room. This, to bring it, if we're going to do this, and we're going to do it once in our lifetime here, we should do it right and bring it up to present code and to perceived use of the building. We want this ready for the next couple of decades. You know, and I think if you're going to do it right at this point in time.
Yeah. Pat?
Yeah, in relationship to the timeline, a lot of this was done last year, I believe, is when we actually got going. And it was long before we brought in the magic man, Art Pongrass, who basically can direct us in a whole new direction, I believe. With him on board, I think we'll get a better grip as far as what the timeline is going to be once we have the architect in place and everything else. We have a wealth of knowledge there that we didn't have at the table before.
Right.
So I think that's just going to help us out tremendously.
I just make one more comment. When you mentioned about the kids graduating from, at one point it'll be one school, two campuses. So it'll just be a physical building graduation if the seniors are there. So no included in that. If you don't function as two completely separate units, that has implications for sports on a whole array of things. There's class rank and scholarships and, you know, a huge amount of work behind the transfer of those students and the combination of them and all the academic ends. So it would be, at that point, one high school. Okay, even though you say they graduate from Enfield, it's strictly the physical piece of it.
And that would be September 14th.
Yeah, 14-15 school year, we'd go to a one high school, two campus concept. Mm-hmm.
Anyone else on time frame, benchmarks, dates? I just had one comment to add. Along the lines of Carol's comments on cost, the cost benefit, there's a big piece that the Strategic Planning Committee heard, and it was two meetings of recommendations from all the department heads on what a combined high school would mean curriculum-wise and course offering-wise. Mm. And, of course, all the numbers have to be fleshed out and to see do we have classroom space or lab space. But it's a tremendous add of courses that would be available, keeping the same number of teachers. And in some departments, the department directors were suggesting a reduction of a teacher or two within the department. And just to read through, and Matt, that's probably something we should get out to everybody.
Yeah.
Are there presentations where you just would see what is offered today and what, in their opinion, would be offered tomorrow, moving up the scale in, say, in mathematics, so that grade 9 is starting at a course level that they would typically start in 10. But then how does that domino down up through the senior class, and what additional higher level courses can be offered? So, to me, that was an exciting piece, because in the end, that's what this consolidation, this combination should really be about, is how do you better education. And a lot of parents are screaming for advanced placement courses or Latin, things that may only, a course that may have 5 or 10 students at each high school, and it's tough to justify, but when you put the populations together and all of a sudden you're at 20, it's a class that you can justify. And so I think that's where there's some huge gains by consolidation, just in the presentations. That was, yeah, it was great information to
listen. Those presentations are on the school district's webpage.
Okay.
So if you'd go to www.enfieldschools.org, go to the boards page, and then come down to the minutes of the meetings, and you look up school consolidation. It says school consolidation, and just go to the minutes there, and they're reproduced in their entirety, the reports.
Yeah,
that booklet's on the page.
It's booklet right there.
Yeah, okay. That booklet.
Yeah, and that's an entire both school teacher effort.
Right.
a lot of meetings and a lot of discussion, and close examination of the High School Reform Act for the state between now and 2020. There are several steps that are, and goals that are met that targets. For math is a good example. You know, all students will be at Algebra 2. That has implications all the way back to the sixth grade. So that's an entire process that will occur anyway. This just gives a much, much more focused chance to see where it would go in one high school with, as Scott said, offerings of courses that may not be supported in a two high school scenario, given the current projection of enrollments.
Yeah. Okay, anyone else on point three? Okay, thank you, gentlemen. Item number four is possible options for the reuse of Fermi High School. We had, so to kind of lay the groundwork for the steering committee, actually once the previous board had made a decision that at that time, and I think that goes back 6 to 8 months ago, that Enfield High was the preferred choice of a high school. Prior to the ratification just a couple weeks ago by the current board of Enfield, we started thinking about reuse, because there's a lot of needs in town. You don't have to look further than 100 yards to the west of Town Hall, and you see a school building that's boarded up and hasn't been used, and no one involved in the strategic planning committee wanted that to be a result of any work that we were doing as a town council and a board of ed. So really, based on that decision that Enfield was the preferred choice, people started the discussions, and discussions happened earlier, and there was a lot of variations. But we really started churning and having some discussions about the reuse of Fermi. Folks have, we know it's a long identified need, and hey, Matt, I had asked if our library director could be here. Is Henry here?
I don't believe so.
Okay.
Yeah.
So we know Henry's a huge advocate for adequate library space based on statistics that say a community the size of Enfield should have a even though we're moving away from books and we're going into new technologies, you still need physical space, you still need stacks, you still need different type of work stations, conference rooms, as part of a library. And so the idea was, could Fermi be used as a new public library space-wise? We also know that people have been clamoring for a community center. There's very little free available space, free meaning access to, for organizations to meet as a group in a meeting type of setting. And would Fermi be a potential for a community center? And so then through those discussions, Matt, did you come up with any figures as to square footage that could be available? Thought process of if we were to move in that direction, how it would fit within the entire scope?
Yeah.
And then we can take questions or comments from the group.
Yeah. Fermi High School itself is approximately 215,000 square foot. You take off the gymnasium, you take off the pool, and some of the large areas like the cafeteria, you're left with about, I think it was around 170,000 square foot. And so that would be the usable space that you'd be looking at for potentially for a library, for meeting spaces. You know, obviously it has an auditorium that seats 586 people as well. You know, the amenities of having an indoor pool, a gymnasium, you know, would add to our ability for recreation programming. And that would be, you know, part of that community center approach would be to move our recreation programming out to that facility as well. But, you know, when you look at the three floors that make up the high school outside of those big big, large areas, you know, you have more than enough space to fit a library of again, in what Henry's been talking about, approximately 70,000 square foot within that. You know, obviously, you'd be looking at a multiple floor concept, but it can be done. And, you know, looking at, again, I don't have any good cost numbers for you, but when you're looking at what surrounding communities and communities in Connecticut are looking to build that size of a library, we're talking probably $12, $15 million easily for a 70,000 square foot library. When you look at a building that, you know, you already have the envelope, you know, really all you're doing is renovating to create the space you need for a library, it's going to be a dramatic savings. And to be able to achieve that without spending $15 to $20 million for all those things we just talked about is a tremendous gain, a tremendous amenity for a community without spending the dollars that surrounding communities, you know, are going to spend to produce the same result.
Tim?
I commend you folks for doing good planning, because we don't want to have something like we have next door, actually. And I think if we didn't, we wouldn't be doing our due diligence if we did do the kind of planning that we have. And I think that it's not cast in stone. Whenever you get discussing these kinds of things, I know there's all kinds of comments out there about what's going on and what we're thinking. What we're doing is thinking. We're thinking out loud and say, how can we use this facility for the benefit of the town? And I think all these types of ideas are saying, what are the needs of the town? How can we reuse this type of facility and give something back to the town? A lot of ideas that, you know, one of which was an educational idea, and it seems a lot of folks have the idea that they should just move JFK up there, and that's the best place to put it. And I think that's what Scott was saying, that I'd like to throw a few comments in there of an educational nature. Fermi was built as a high school, okay? Although we have a gym and we have a pool and we have an auditorium, we have a very specific structure at the middle school which deals with a house plan and a team organization. And the rooms are laid out that way. The labs are laid out that way. The library is laid out that way. The cafeteria, it spokes off the wheel, and it's very, very easy to supervise. Fermi was laid out as a high school, a traditional high school with different wings. It has a science wing. It has a business wing. It has the academic wing and the tower building there, the three floors there. It's not laid out at all for supervising middle school youngsters. And I think folks, and I understand it, they think that we just open, close one building, we can just move the other one there. It'll fit the kids there. We can get the student bodies there, but it doesn't lend itself to the curriculum or to the organization. I mean, the middle school is part of a philosophy, the way it's designed, because kids get lost in a middle school if you don't supervise them and have them in small units. We don't do it haphazardly. We have them broken down into teams. They stay together. We call it looping for 2 years, so that some adult knows who these kids are and follows them all the way through. And youngsters of that age need that level of supervision. It wouldn't, in my mind, and haven't looked at it, and I worked it for me for 3 years, I don't see how you would do it. And I see it would be a very, very difficult building to supervise. I'm not sure how you would do it at all. And I think you need to have the structure fit the form and the organization that you're putting in there, and I think it's critical to do that. If you did do it, you'd have some expenses, just like we did at the elementary school. We had to put kindergartens in the pre-K to two schools. I mean, there are different setups in there for little kids, as there are different setups for high school kids. And I think the type of science that we offer there would not be suitable in a high school chemistry lab. In fact, I'm not sure there'd be sufficient lab space to do that without some major renovations. I think the code work that we've been putting off until we make this decision, I would guess that we would have to bring it up to code, because the same issues would be in place there. And I think the other issue is that JFK still has a bill due to the state on that. And I'm not sure what that was. I bet Tina or Jen has that number for me. 1.9? Okay. The reason that people have told me they wanted to do that is they want to put all the elementary people in the current JFK facility. And I think all that, if you look around, people aren't going to large elementary schools for some of the same reasons that we don't, that we structure a middle school differently than we do a high school. Kids get lost in that situation. And I never thought that the reorganization process was to consolidate the entire town into three buildings. And I think that's one of the issues that that I'm concerned about as an educator, and having been in the building and supervised those kids for the last 40 years, you know, it's problematic. It's $1.2 million, and so for those reasons, I just like people to consider that. I think some of the reasons that have been given to me is that we need to use those fields. We would never tap into the use of those fields with any kind of middle school program. In fact, we're talking about intramurals versus interscholastic sports, or along with interscholastic sports. I think it would get used more for PE classes than it would get used for as any kind of a sports program that would be there. But I think the biggest issue in terms of looking at it and trying to transplant the kids to that building would be it just doesn't fit the structure of the school, and there's some huge cost involved. I don't think it's a good educational decision. So I just wanted to put it out there. I know I've talked to you, Scott, and I appreciate it. But I think we think of schools, we think of just transplanting people. It's not that simple. In fact, anything we think is simple is not that simple, okay? Or cheap.
That's true.
So thank you for allowing me those few words
there. Thanks, Tim. Tom?
Yeah, I just want to back up just a little bit quickly and what you said, Scott, about, you know, the reason, you know, the consolidation and, you know, advanced placement classes and the classes that will be available to our children. You know, father four, graduated four children out of Fermi myself, well, one left right now, and one would now with grandchildren. I would look forward to my grandchildren being able to take, you know, more advanced classes, better class systems in the high school level. With that being said, I think it's a great idea to take Fermi and go into a community center. I've heard some noise on our neighborhood center downtown, and people are afraid that would be closed if we were to consolidate or put a community center in Fermi. I'd like to, you know, make that, I would not support that. I would hope that, you know, the neighborhood center would stay open. And you know, Fermi just having no bill either is a great thing for us to take that building over, and the library is great. It's a beautiful setup they have now, and I think it worked great for the community. Thanks.
Jen? Thanks, Tom.
I don't know if Dr. Gallagher or Matt can verify. Since we'd have to do updates to keep Fermi as a school, so even if it was to become the middle school, we would have to pay that $2 to $3 million. But if it's a community center, we are not required to do that. Is that correct?
Correct.
it would be different standards. They have different standards. Even with a school, you have different standards for a preschool where they come in, there's different standards. So there'd be, I mean, obviously it's a public building, so it has to be handicap accessible, but it wouldn't be to the level that you have when you have students in it. It obviously would be a, but I don't want you to think that they might not come in and say, you know, you need to do this because of a new handicap law. There'd be some.
Okay.
Tom?
One of the things I know that I heard that you had done in the works that you had done over the last year and a half was talk about the enrollment decline in the past 10 years and looking ahead 5 to 10 years, best expectations, and how this plan would be able to react to a change in that, if the demographics for some reason.
Yeah, sure. Let me tell you about the plan itself. When you do the paperwork for the state, they require an 8-year projection on what you think the enrollment will be over an 8-year period for the new building, or the remodeled building. And we've been playing phone tag with our demographer. We use a fellow that's worked for us. He was actually a state employee that did them for years, for a school demographer. And I think the guy's on vacation. I think he's going to come back and get the voicemails we've left. So he'll give us a number that shows what's going out. But the district itself has been dropping about 200 students a year. And what's been hard to guess that right now is with the opening of the magnet schools, we're seeing more students with magnets going to the magnets. And I think that was part of our intention with this, that if we could have a more modern 21st century type building, it would retain our students. They wouldn't go look at a brand new magnet school and think, boy, this is really nice, I'd like to go to this building. So we can give you the stats. I can go back. We can go back years on our enrollment. But you are getting smaller. I think in Enfield, part of it's the birth rate. The kindergarten classes are definitely smaller. And then as they move through, they start opting out for middle schools. It used to be in sixth grade, but right now, magnet schools, so many of them now are offering pre-K programs and full-day kindergartens. So we're even seeing some of our parents that work in Hartford or work in Bloomfield or work in a town that has a magnet school that offers that,
deciding to take their child to work, drop them there, and pick them up at the end of the day. So it's a little bit tricky to guess the magnet schools, but as far as the cohort survival and the birth rates, they're pretty solid numbers based on that.
So I understand that. I understand we lost around 50.
About 50 or so to the magnets, but you've dropped about almost 200 students a year for the last four
down,
or 5 years.
And, yes. And I understand
that's
that.
That's K-12. That's not just high school.
Right. That's to be attributed not to a population moving out of town, but to a population which is having kids later.
Yes, and
fewer
kids.
And smaller families.
Yes.
As the major, and we do we see a trend in the future that that's changing anywhere else, or is that
no? I think we share that trend with Manchester, East Hartford, the more traditional suburbs. The ones that are growing are like the Glastonbury's and the Ellingtons.
Right.
Their numbers are coming up.
More people are moving in.
They got space to build, and they're building big homes that have 3-4 bedrooms that are large houses, and people come and fill them up.
Thanks, Tom. Ken, Fermi. Could we also incorporate the Child Development Center into Fermi? Or do we have other plans to move that facility? Because I know we're leasing space right now.
Well, I think as we looked at a lot of the different, you know, if again, kind of going maybe a little bit forward into the agenda here, you know, if the library were to be relocated, then we have the concern of what do we do with the library? And as you're aware, we're going to be the lease with the Child Development Center on South Road comes up actually next year.
Mm-hmm.
So we're going to have to be finding a place for it. You know, one of the early concepts we had was possibly Stowe, but now with, you know, the concept of the library moving out, maybe the library has a better, you know, environment there, especially with the amenity that's going to be added there by way of the Rotary and Lego building a fairly large accessible park right there, that, you know, maybe there's some synergy there. It would make more sense to move it into it. So I think, you know, there's a lot of opportunities to come out of you know, this one high school consolidation that, again, you know, we wouldn't be able to as a community from the standpoint of the cost of building facilities to do, but from the cost of renovating, we would be able to do.
Right, because, I mean, that's a pretty substantial cost savings, too, if we can get out of that lease.
It's
or
about $136,000
a year, right, plus all the utilities and
yep.
stuff like that. And then next would be, I know some of the seniors have concerns going forward with this, but the community center would also benefit them because Susan could schedule programs for swimming and any gym activities and stuff like that, which could kind of be an expansion on her programming at the senior center, which, you know, without having to do a build out there for a pool or something like that, would give them a lot more access without the seniors going into a school environment type of situation. So
yeah, it would definitely, and I'm sorry to interrupt, but yeah. It would definitely allow us to expand recreational opportunities, especially aquatic, that we can't do right now.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I think you're absolutely right. A lot of communities that have those amenities will have a lot of programs aimed at senior citizens mm-hmm. through aquatics and through the gym. I mean, it would be an incredible amenity that, again, would become available because of the foresight of the consolidation of mm-hmm. the high schools.
I mean, even the winter gym time, walking around, and yep. I think that that's a positive note, too, for the seniors. So,
very true.
Thank you.
During the school day, too, which is not
allowed. Absolutely, right,
right.
right. Without
that's
going
huge.
Into
that's
the
huge.
School
yeah.
environment. Yeah, absolutely. Yep.
All set.
Thank you.
Pat?
Yeah. Also, another possibility that we thought about for me in our discussion was in lieu of our recent snowfall last October, we needed to find a shelter. We could actually use Fermi as that shelter without impacting any of the schools, which was very important. It may not be a townwide reason that we have to open a shelter, maybe a smaller problem that is surfacing in town. We need to house somebody somewhere where the community center at Fermi would allow us to do that without impacting any type of a school. So I think that's very important also, because, you know, when you open up the schools to a shelter, you're opening it up townwide to everybody, and we're not screening people that come in. So I just think having something like that available to us would be a big asset to us too.
Thanks, Pat. Cindy?
Thank you. You know, we're looking at a couple of different options for a couple of different buildings, schools, and town buildings. Probably would be very appropriate at some point to to identify on paper, iPad, what have you, all of the available buildings, all of the possibilities for the buildings, as what Matt, you know, was referring to, with regards to moving the child daycare perhaps over to the library because of the Lego playground would be a nice fit, and looking at Fermi for the library expansion, community center. And at that point, we're going to need to bring our brainstorming ideas to the public in some sort of a fashion, a paper, if you will, so that we can get some input from the people of Enfield as to what their thoughts are as well. It's good to look at several different buildings. It's good to identify uses and purposes, but there are more. There are more of these buildings out there that we have that maybe we can start to identify and really put some focus on the domino effect. If you're going to look at this, what happens to this? You know, and then we've got to have plan B in the event, God forbid, this referendum fails. You know, we have to look at the whole picture, not just this building. If you do it this way, this building. I think we need to look at all the pieces. And maybe we can maybe ask town staff to get us a list of all those buildings and all the opportunities for some of the changes that we could make. That was my thought. Thank you.
Great. Thanks, Cindy. Vinny?
Well, I'm hearing some really great ideas, and we talked the other night, and I'm glad to see some really proactive ideas shooting around this town with the different buildings. But I just want people to understand, when this referendum is brought up, we're voting on the high school. Let's not get this all involved or mixed up with the other uses of the buildings right now, because you might not have people agree with what we're doing with Fermi. We might have people agree what we're doing with the old library. Let's focus in on the consolidation of the two high schools and what's better for the kids and overall the town, and getting that passed, or hopefully it gets passed that way. Let's not like get it all mixed up and confuse the voters on that. So I want to move forward with that. These other ideas, it'll snowball afterwards, and we can focus on that afterwards. But right now, I'd love to just focus on the consolidation part and getting that done first.
Tom?
To Vinny's point, that's actually an idea that might help. That is to put together, Matt, maybe a public meeting, open meeting agenda that once we get the high school referendum ready to go, that after that we would have a now let's talk about uses.
What are the other possibilities here?
It actually really completely separated, knowing we're going to do, and I think we have time to do that. We're not going to, you know, not do or do a community center because we waited until November 7th to have that first public meeting about what that use might be. So let everybody know that.
Yeah.
Might be a good thing to not lose any votes on that referendum because someone thinks that, you know, we're going to do this or that.
There's a risk of not saying what a vision is, and there's a risk of saying what the vision is. Because I could just hear folks now if we said, and I agree with, I mean, our focus has to be on, it's a high school consolidation. The referendum is on Enfield High School. And that's, in the end, that's what the voters are going to vote yes or no on, based on a whole host of issues, all individual, all personal, how they vote one way or the other. But at least at the Strategic Planning Committee, we debated and we said, well, if you don't come out with some form of path, vision, understanding, then the people are going to come back and say, well, then you're just going to leave a one school, whatever it is, totally empty and unused, and what are you going to do with that? So I've always looked at it's better to throw ideas and vision out there so it sits in the back of their mind.
Yeah.
With the full focus on a referendum and getting really the details out on what does the high school consolidation mean to education, and what does the cost of a renovated, expanded Enfield High School mean to the residents and the taxpayers, bottom line numbers. Because in the end, that's what they're approving. They're approving a cost. They're approving a bond.
I think you have to even go further. I think it's irresponsible for us not to plan for the town. These are options. Nothing's been cast in stone. These are options. There'll probably be more thrown on the table as we go along. But I go even a little bit further and say, it's not just what we're providing for the students. I think we're putting something together that's a huge asset to the town. John spoke about it. We have another high school that, you know, kids are going there because of some of the things that they have there. And, you know, we have a dated high school. We're not in the 21st century, although we are. And I think we want to get our kids prepared for the world they have to go out to. And I think that makes it a selling point for Enfield. I think to have something that's, up to date, that would draw kids, draw parents to the town, and I think be an asset in all kinds of other ways in terms of a community facility and so on. And the other piece of it, just part of, I think, good proactive planning, yeah, that we want to add things to the town.
Donna?
I like the vision. I think without the vision, you can't see the integration of the town. And I think that sometimes I feel that the town thinks that education is something separate that they do and not integral to the community. And I think that when you see something like this, it shows that moving forward educational-wise allows us to move forward as a town. And I like the vision.
Craig?
I don't mean, I'm doing very short. I agree with the both of you. Vinny, I see your point. And I think our task is where we sit is for the high school consolidation and the whole renewal referendum. I think it's important to understand the parallel that the community is going to ask these questions. And I even go to the extent of maybe the wise thing to do is to put together a think tank that's separate from us right now. And I mean, from what we're doing, citizens, maybe department heads, you've got the library director, you've got social service director, you've got youth services, you've got recreation department, and let them go off to the side and begin, you know, Mac and guide them about what buildings and just to create different, you know, ideas of what could happen to come back to. That way, that work is being done by someone else, but we can't tackle that now. But I don't want to see us wait until November 7th to start having some concrete ideas. I mean, there's folks that are not connected to the referendum, to what we're doing in our town staff and stuff and folks and citizens, that maybe they, a good think tank, you know. You guys go over there and brainstorm, and we're going to get you back to us and tell you what you think, so. Just a thought out there. So.
My apologies for not being clear. What I meant was, we're doing this, we keep it separate. We put forth the vision as we're talking about it now, with the caveat that at November 7th we will start the
right.
the committee, the public input process for stage two,
right,
whatever that's going to look like, and that we're committing to using it. And right, here's the vision, but we're not committing to what that result vision is actually going to look like. And I think if you say that to the public, that's going to concrete keep the issue of the schools, and it's also going to do what Scott said and Donna said, to promote a vision. But we're not making the decision on that vision today.
And let me say, I totally agree. That, to be honest with you, we shouldn't even be thinking about to after the referendum whether it passed or not, because that's going to be the target date. But if you have this group over here, this think tank, and they've been working on these things, you know, right after that election and that referendum, they have a wealth of information. They can go right into it, yep, advising, instead of waiting to put everything together to start researching after we start doing the research now. Let another group do it for us. Right. It's similar to where we had the search for the superintendent for the schools. We had somebody come in and put together focus groups and begin to get community input. That way, the council and the board can be guided after that election. Just my thanks.
Okay, John.
If we're doing a little visioning here, I'd like to throw two on the table. One is a thing that we've had in the past that the parents have come back to me and requested. I would hope that if we could do this, we just need maybe three rooms at Fermi, but to consider bringing back the alternative high school as a site for the alternative high school. And it would be complemented by the library being there. My next one, you'll think either I'm a genius or a madman. But before I say it, before I say it, remember that we went to work and spoke to CREC, and the CREC is renting, and I believe the town's getting about $275 a year on the rental. You've removed yourself from some of the cost of the maintenance and the utilities. I'm watching some of the state buildings in town, and I'm hearing that the Department of Motor Vehicle Building is in trouble. They're probably going to close it down. I wonder if someone would want to go to the state and say, are there state buildings in town that would be willing to rent partial space in a building the size of Fermi? For example, the DMV, the Motor Vehicle Department. Would that be something? I think your library could fit in there easily, and I don't think they need that much space.
you might be able to. There's several state buildings in town, and we've got good relationships with our state rep and Senator Kissel. Maybe we should be sitting down there talking to these guys, saying, you know, if you're just putting a temporary skim on that roof to keep it from leaking right now, and you're trying to decide what you're doing with it, rather than closing it down and moving it completely out of Enfield because it is a good service, maybe they would be interested in moving it into a school that could be renovated a little bit for them and pay the town some rent.
Madman. No.
Genius. Just trying to be efficient use of buildings.
Tom.
John, I spent 3 hours in Weathersfield and in DMV just yesterday. And I really miss our Enfield DMV.
That's right.
Terribly. And you just said that word right now, you know, that they may not open it. Wow. I'd love to try to find him some room, because traveling to Weathersfield for all our residents is it's just excessive.
All right. Anyone else on item four? And Matt, just because I know we've had conversations about library, and we have the long-range plan for the library. But I would like, you know, everyone says, you know, the group that's off on the side. It would be good for Henry and whoever to sit down and really look at Fermi, and does Fermi work in a long-range plan for a library? You know, an architect may look at Fermi to say, no, you can't pull down those interior walls because they're support walls. And a library tends to have more of an open floor space. And we've got to do that kind of work before anyone thinks that any building would be great for something. It really all depends if that something can actually happen there architecturally. So, and does it fit into the long-range plan of a library? I mean, can a library be two floors? I say yes, but I'm not the professional. Okay. We may have already covered this, but discussion of consolidation issues and next steps. Number five. Have we kind of had that through the different points, Bill?
I have a small one, and I apologize for not saying it earlier. I was stepped away from the table. Matt, could you request from staff just a statement or a description of the borrowing environment, you know, at this point, just so we have that in the
it's very good right
cash.
Now.
I think we all recognize that, but if as we're assembling things that are going to be shared with the public in the pros and cons category,
right.
Just an overview of why it's good and how that kind of impacts what we're proposing here down the road. And is the forecast, you know, does that remain good for the foreseeable future?
Right. Because we don't bond until they...
We don't bond until we actually spend, right?
Until they spend.
Yeah. Right. And how it layers onto our current debt and debt payments.
And that would actually be part of all the information that we'd be putting together for the referendum as well.
Right. Okay. So as you pay off others and you're layering this, what's the impact? Are there any other discussion of consolidation issues, next steps? Pat?
Just on the vision. Is that where we're at now, or are we still
Number five.
Okay, I'll hold off.
Tim?
I would just I'd flesh out those meeting dates and, you know, and kind of put together a draft agenda for what we're going to discuss with those things. You said like every 6 weeks, just so people see that on the horizon. I mean, they're not on the draft that Matt just went over, but I think getting them locked in so people know it's coming, and access to with the stuff John said it's on the school website, access to what we're presenting here. We're doing this tonight not just for ourselves but also for the public, so they're aware of where we are, how we got here, and where we're headed. But I think the more we can spec out for people so they know it's going to happen and they kind of see the roadmap to get us there, I think that would be good as a communication vehicle.
Okay. Scott. Bill?
I had a question, and I don't know who can answer. Maybe Donna can even answer. When you identify a firm to take on the architectural task and the development of the concept, do they often plan as part of that process different points where input is typically sought? I mean, so will we expect our architect to say, all right, in 4 weeks after we begin, or the week we begin, we want input of this nature? Do we know that? Yeah, is that typical?
Well, yeah, and I think, you know, as part of the selection process, that Art will be leading us through, you know, we'll be making sure that they understand that there is an engagement concept that has to be undertaken within their contract.
Okay.
And so then we can start looking, you know, from that, once we have the firm under contract, we can start planning out, you know, what are the most appropriate time frames to have those engagement activities.
All right. That's good.
Okay. Pat?
Yeah, on the discussions of salvation, I just think it needs to be out there that this wasn't just a committee that got together. We included administration, department heads, town councils, board of education, all kinds of staff to get the facts and figures together. It wasn't something that we just decided we wanted to do and it was rammed down anyone's throat. This has been a long, thought-out process, and we've been meeting since last year on this issue. So I just want, I think that should be out there, that this wasn't just a, okay, let's combine the two high schools and get it done next year type thing. This was something that we put a lot of time into. And the administration and department heads have done absolutely a fantastic job. They presented a lot of different scenarios to us. We've had a lot of different, our ideas have changed from the start when we first started our very first meeting, when we just started talking about this. A lot of information has come forward, and it's changed a lot of where we were heading. I mean, so I just want it to be out there that this wasn't just something that was thought of by a couple people behind closed doors, like people claim sometimes this happens. This has been open meetings, and a lot of people have attended. The principals from both high schools, and our former principal, Tim Neville, he was there from JFK. Through the consolidation of the middle schools, I mean, the elementary into the middle, and now into the high school. So a lot of people, I've heard people be kind of cynics about it, but I haven't seen them at these meetings. And they're open to the public, and if you have questions, please contact us. To write something in a blog that's not going to be responded to, that's not it. We don't mind. We love positive. We also like the fact that there's going to be some negative comments out there that we can address. But please bring them to our attention and come to our meetings and talk to them in public. Bring your ideas and your concerns up in public. That's really what we want. We don't want a closed door type thing, and we're not trying to ram anything down the voters' throats. We're really looking at the vision for the next 20 to 25 years here in Enfield of where the high school can be and how it can be. So I just think it's important that people know that they're welcome to come to these meetings, and they're welcome. We're going to have open forum, I hope so, so they can come and speak and hopefully get some answers to their questions and their concerns. And like I just said, I just want you to know the administration and the teachers and department heads have been on board with all this. This isn't something that the town council is trying to do to save money or the Board of Education is trying to do to lose a school. We've worked hard on it and put a lot of thought into it. So I hope people come and they speak, whether you're in favor or against. We need to know about this. Because if it's something that's going to be dead to water, we need to know that too. Because there's a lot of other things riding on this one referendum. So that's
all that. Thanks, Pat. Anyone else under discussion of consolidation issues, next steps? So we identified a next step as getting as quickly as we can the dates defined for the public informational meetings once the architect has been engaged, and the multiple forums to be held. Any other next steps, John or Matt, that you know of besides what's here on our timeline? Okay, then number six was a vision for future use of other town facilities, Central Library, Stowe. There's been references already made to that during the discussion. Anyone have? I did ask Matt to invite department heads, and I know Pam Brown is here from Social Services. So, Pam, is there anything that you want to talk about
Child Development Center?
Child Development Center? Here, come on up. Here's an empty seat, right?
Ladies and gentlemen, I think that the possibility of having the Child Development Center be at the library would be very beneficial. I think there would be adequate space to meet the needs, and again, being in the center of town would be accessible to families. The new playground being there, as well as being near the other school, would, I think all of those would be very positive. So I think it would be a very good plan for the Child Development Center. Staff are, well, we haven't told the whole staff, but the...
Right. You know now.
Right. But the directors are, you know, very excited about that prospect.
It's just that vision thing.
Right.
Any questions or comments to Pam? Tom?
Along with that, Matt, is there a way, without getting an architect involved, to just sit down with a blueprint of Fermi and say, all right, if Henry wants 60,000 square feet, all right, we've got down on the base floor where we would put this library, we've got 81,000 square feet. So let's put the library there, and we'll have 20,000 extra. And if we bring a community center in, takes up the large spaces and some of the small spaces, roughly what we would have left so that we could have input. Perhaps there's another thing, whether it be reserve space to expand the ones we bring over, or it be new ones we haven't mentioned yet, that would also come over to Fermi to see if it's, you know, well, we're only going to have 5,000 square feet left if we do these two things.
We actually asked, when we engaged the architect, at the very high level, we're asking the architect to look at the possibilities in the other buildings. Not to the detail of what we need to do at Enfield High for the one high school.
Just like a kind of a square footage available.
Sort of a
quick overview.
Yeah, and there's a couple things you got to keep in mind, though, is that, you know, you can look at square footage and say, well, yeah, you can fit 70,000 square foot of library in there. But I think as referenced before, if, you know, you can't relocate walls or do things like that, then all of a sudden you really don't have a functioning space for the library. So, you know, having an architect on board is almost mandatory to be able to say that yes, you can do this, or no, you can't do it.
So we would wait till that point and then ask that overview question initially so that they could take a quick look and say,
yeah, I think
you're not going to be able to do that, or you are going to be able to.
Yeah, for very, very little time, very little money, you know, they'll be able to take a look at that for us to say, you know, what are the possibilities of Fermi?
I just have a feeling that it's going to allow us to bring maybe something else, even extra over there that perhaps we haven't thought of.
Yeah.
When you do a library, there's a grant letter that's done, because all libraries are funded, not necessarily just by towns. There's the grant system in the state, and for that you would have a grant letter, and in that grant letter the architect would come in with his consultants, and they would do a feasibility study for this and look at, is this a feasible place to have a library? And that would be the initial grant letter, and that would start the process of, from what I've seen, it going forward.
Okay, anything else for Pam?
Oh, not for Pam, no.
Tom, go ahead.
And then that leaves us with Stowe. And I'd like to see Stowe, too, look into, I know the seniors are looking for a, you know, kind of a Mark Twain, too. Getting my first letters from AARP now, I would be interested in
myself. I'm getting 5 years now.
What do you mean, first letters?
Well, it's time to join. I think it'd be a nice use for that property, too. Thank you.
Jen?
Well, I'm just thinking down the road from the Board of Ed perspective. Eventually, you know, at the state, they're already telling us that the all-day kindergarten will be coming down the way.
Yeah, okay.
As soon as that gets implemented, it will be close after that. We'll have to be required to get preschool. So Stowe would be a great facility for a town-wide preschool.
I think on the same vein, I think we just be careful of that, because we know these things are coming. They're imminent, and we just got to make sure that our enrollment and our facilities mesh, and then we can provide the types of programs we have to do.
Right, because we're efficient right now,
yeah.
And
yeah,
we really can't fit more programs in. And when the state mandates more programs, we're going to have to reconsider.
What's the time frame?
Joyce, you've been keeping track of that, I think, haven't you?
To a large extent, yeah.
Yeah.
The mandate part will probably come as a result of any proposals that come from the state during this legislative session. And those are all being done through committee, each, like the Education Committee, for example, because no individual legislators can put in bills, but they'll be coming in as committee bills. And with the governor concentrating on education with the various task forces that have been working for the last year, the ECS will not be impacted until next year because the two-year budget mandates that. But the ECS committee will report in October, and the future will be clearer for some of us. The Achievement Gap Task Force has gone beyond focusing on just those big cities that have obvious gaps and indicated that they recognize that the gap exists statewide. And so their proposals will potentially come out this year. Exactly what anybody's going to propose this year, I do not have an idea, except that something will be coming forward without a doubt.
Another mandate.
Okay,
another mandate. Donna.
Tom, in your question, Matt, do you know what happened with the Noah Webster School where the crack used to be?
Privately owned.
Yeah, it's privately owned. It's still open. Yeah.
Privately owned, but do they have somebody in that facility?
No, it's up for sale right now, as a matter of fact.
Okay. Because that is a sister building to the Stowe, which would be really a much better conversion for us than to take new facilities with new gymnasiums and things like that and turn it into a housing situation. To take a building that needs renovation, that is of a sister design that's compatible. So maybe... I know it'd be tough to say. Maybe we should consider buying it back, but
no, those are wonderful ideas, and you know, actually, it'd be nice to fill that building because it went in disarray. And that's something I think the Housing Authority. You know, we don't know what the Housing Authority can get with grants and money themselves. So, and again, it's not all our decision. It's more of the Housing Authority, and I think those are great questions for them.
John?
Just there's more information. This is the amortization table for Stowe, and that's, you can see it's going around. This past September, it was $1,033,000 approximately if it wasn't being used as a school. So, and they count credit using it as a school, so there's no, you're still getting credit for what you use as a school.
Okay. So the final, nothing's owed on Stowe back to the state in 2025.
Yes, September 1, 2025. Okay. You're even.
Thank you, John. All right, anything else on item 6?
Motion to adjourn.
Is there anything else for the group?
Wow.
Vinny wants to adjourn.
Motion to adjourn.
I just want to bring up that we talked about in our goals meeting, and that was at Fermi. With the shop wing where it is, the possibility of having an EMS subsidiary, substation over there. So they'd kind of be covering both sides of town a little more easy.
Yes.
Because ambulances would fit inside that shop wing.
Right.
Garage doors. So I just want to bring that up.
More vision. Okay. Anything else? Motion to adjourn?
Second.
By all, seconded by all. All those in favor?
Aye.
Those opposed, we are adjourned. Have a good evening.